Jesus.
Second verse now, lo, the promise of Jesus.
Lo, the promise of your Savior.
Pardon sin and purchase favor.
Pardon sin and purchase favor.
Called us to be a special people. He has called us to be separated from the world. And he's asking us, you need to set the example for the others. And therefore he's asking us to be holy. Because that is what we need to be today. Because we're a chosen generation. We are royal people, people. And God is asking us to be holy, for he is holy.
Broken.
let us all stand.
Turn to the first page of your bulletin as you read the affirmation of faith. We'll read together. All humanity is now involved in a great controversy between Christ and Satan regarding the character of God, his law, and his sovereignty over the universe. This conflict originated in heaven when a created being endowed with freedom of choice in self-exaltation became Satan, God's adversary, and led into rebellion a portion of the angels. He introduced the spirit of rebellion into this world when he led Adam and Eve into sin. This human sin resulted in the distortion of the image of God in humanity, the disordering of the created world, and its eventual devastation at the time of the worldwide flood. Observed by the whole creation, this world became the arena of the universal conflict, out of which the God of love will ultimately be vindicated. To assist his people, Christ sends the Holy Spirit and the loyal angels to guide, protect, and sustain them in the way of salvation.
Invite your presence this morning, Lord. We do so not because we are worthy, but because in the name, in the power, and the blood of Jesus Christ, we are welcome in your presence. For this we are grateful, and we rejoice in your presence today. In the name of Jesus, amen.
One of my favorite texts at this time on a Sabbath the text from Psalm 122, where he says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. It has always been my delight to be in the house of the Lord on the Sabbath day. Whenever circumstances, and those have been few, have not permitted me to be in church on Sabbath, like a curious little boy, I ask, what went on? Who preached? Who gave the music? Etc., etc., etc. It is a good thing to be in the church on the Sabbath. Then I am forced to make just a brief comment, Pastor, on the new doxology. Sister Rosie, it is special. I'm reminded of the favorite line in a pastoral prayer of Elder G. Ralph Thompson. And some of you may be acquainted with it. He likes to talk about the stately steppings of the Holy Spirit. I rather suspect that doxology is an appropriate welcome to the stately steppings of the Holy Spirit into the service this morning. I've been asked to give the welcome, and I will try my best, Dr. Faz, to keep within the constrictions. Sorry, did I say constrictions? Whatever that word means. But let me start this way. There are many visitors here this morning, and I'm not going to call all, but Sister Ward, Sister Cynthia asked me to have all the visitors stand so that they can get the tokens. So all visitors, would you presently stand so you can get these tokens while I continue speaking? Visitors, wherever you are. Good. I understand that there are 18 youngsters from Rafa House. Rafa House, I've been told, is a subunit of Love Until. And they are the ones who are superintending and guiding and directing. The two leaders from Rafa House, Sister Candice McDonald and Brother David Barker. Could you just raise your hands where you are so I could see who these two persons are? Candice, are you there? Oh, they're downstairs. Oh, so have the children come up then? Oh, they haven't come up yet. Well, they will be coming, so they are welcomed in absentia. Then I must make special mention of at least two visitors here this morning. These ladies walked this campus in the 1930s, and they are here looking well and looking strong. Dr. Wilma Gooding and a sister, Inez Gooding. Where are the Gooding sisters? Will they please stand? Excuse me, you were up front earlier. I'm sure you were not demoted to the back. Welcome, Wilma and Inez, and Shalene, who is their caregiver this time. Then we have a gentleman. Pastor, is this your first grand? And he had to be here. Pastor Danny Francis and wife, welcome, and the circumstances which bring joy to you. We welcome back home Dr. and Mrs. Ferdinand. Dr. Leslie, where are you here? Just give me a little wave. All right. Good. Welcome back home. We do have a number of other persons whom I will now group. The USC congregation is composed primarily of students. Am I right?
Yes.
Good. That yes confirmed that. And we do have faculty members and staff members and community members. But I just want to focus briefly on the students. Because you are the kernel of this institution. And you must reflect that as you grow and develop. Who knows what the future will bring for you? I was sent a very brief book just a few weeks ago by a former student of this institution. She sang in the choir, and I taught her. Nice little book entitled Enter Praise Here. Small book. I sat down in my living room and I read it cover to cover, just 113 pages. She encapsulates some of the experiences which she has had in life, including one or two when she was on this campus. And she punctuates the book with these three words, insert praise here. Pastor Horrell, the Horrells of Coal Mine are included in the book. And you want to know now who wrote the book, I'll mention it. She mentions, and I will only touch on one, she taught in the primary school just a few yards from here while she was doing her bachelor's degree in education. And she walked up the incline, which is still there, at the end of school to her classes. Not in this area, these buildings were not here. And she persevered. And she made the point, students, insert praise here. Young people, as you go through the experiences on this campus, I want you to insert praise here to God for the many blessings that He affords you day by day. This welcome at this particular time, I want to classify as just a foretaste of that welcome which we all will have when the saints go marching in, when we go sweeping through the gates to the New Jerusalem, washed in the blood of the Lamb. God help us and continue to bless us in His service today. I want, as a transition to the opening hymn, which is number 596, Look for the Way Marks, I'd like just to give special attention to someone. Sister pianist, would you give me the key of F major, please? Right. Good. That will work. There is someone in our congregation today, and this day is special to him, as he is special to all of us. So I want us to sing Happy Birthday to Dr. Roy McGarrell. Octogenarian. And listen, just a minute. Let's put a little finesse into it, because Dr. Roy is a man of finesse. Follow me closely. Dr. Roy, we'll say, so it fits into the meter. You like that, Roy? Good. Here we go. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Dr. Roy. Happy birthday to you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. May the good Lord bless you. Happy birthday.
birthday, Roy. Our opening hymn, Look for the Waymarks, by the Adventist poet laureate and hymn writer Effie Belden. This is an olden goldie. I associate this hymn with the late H.M.S. Richards of the Voice of Prophecy. I would suspect that some persons with hair like mine should remember this hymn. So, I invite pianist to play the prelude. I will indicate when the congregation stands. Stand. Praise team, I want to hear you, know it or not. Here we go. Sing without accompaniment. A risk, but you'll do it. Here we go.
First the Assyrian kingdom ruled the world, then the Medo-Persia's banners were unfurled.
Lovely.
And after Greece held universal sway, Rome seized the scepter. Where are we?
I come in and look for the way, mark the great prophet. Gusto. Down.
Have your seats.
This is a time that we approach the throne of God. I'm asking those of you who would like to come forward to do so. We're on the platform here. We'll kneel. We approach God's
throne.
congregation can stand, please. Almighty God, Father, Creator, and Redeemer, we, your children, gather to worship you on your holy Sabbath day. We praise you, Father. We magnify your name. We thank you for your love to us, for providing and protecting us during this week. We thank you for the fresh air we breathe and the freedom to worship you in spirit and in truth. Dear God, you have said in your word that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We claim that promise today, Lord, and we ask that you forgive us our sins and cleanse us as we approach your throne of grace. We pray for your church and this university this morning. We know that you will make all wrong things right. We lift up our youth and children, the older ones, the sick and lonely. We pray for our families, our community, our country, and its leaders. We present the preacher for today and ask you to touch his lips, dear Heavenly Father, that they may speak your message, to touch our hearts and minds with your truth. Help us to listen and obey. We commit ourselves to doing your will in our lives, and we anxiously await your soon coming. May we do our part in preparing ourselves and others for this great event, and may we be ready to go home with you, is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Shall have revived by his word, coming from the book of Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 9.
Words of
shall read verses 1 to 9. I'll read the first and you the second. And we shall continue in the same pattern. And we shall conclude in verse 9 together. And Saul, yet breathing out of threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he said, "Who art thou, Lord?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. Together. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink. Amen.
Now is the time where we participate with what we have brought. We have come to worship, to pray, to sing, and also to bring our offerings. Every time I think about our church building and our hopes and dreams for it, I think of Solomon's temple and of how they asked the people to bring offerings. And they brought, and they brought, and they brought until there was so much that they had to tell them, "Okay, that's enough, you can stop now." I am sure Pastor would love to look forward to that day, but meanwhile, we can give and give and give. Let me tell you, I spent time in prayer before I wrote the words and the music to our church building song, and that's why I put in the part where we sing and we say, "I will give cheerfully, I will give faithfully, I will give consistently." Because if you do it, you can't deny yourself that opportunity, which we have right now. Of course, there are two baskets, one for the offering and the light-colored one for the church building. We ask that the deacons stand now as we pray over the offerings that we are happy and cheerful to bring. Thank you, God, for what you have given us, and thank you for our hearts that you have touched to bring to you not only what is yours, but what we want to give you also. We ask that you will bless it to the furtherance of your cause. In Jesus' name, amen. We sing now.
Joy to worship. we are privileged to have at our university students from different nationalities across the Caribbean and many parts of the world. Today, we're delighted to have the Vinada Club, represented by the Vincentians and the Grenadians. Today, I understand, is the celebration of independence for the Isles of Spice. And because we recognize every nationality on this campus, we want to have the national anthem be sung by a group of students from the Vinada Club, so we can celebrate with the great nation of nutmeg, bay leaf, spice, and cocoa. God bless us as we listen to this national anthem. I presume all of us would have to stand in respect of this great nation. I believe it's on the screen. Hail Grenada, land of ours. Seats.
This morning, our scripture reading is taken from Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. I'll be reading and you'll be hearing. And the word of God says, "And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ." There ends the scripture reading.
I invite our president at this time to make a special introduction.
Good morning, church. It's all a joy to welcome all to a worship service today. We're very thankful for the ministry of Dr. John Pauline. He's been with us on Thursday and give an excellent presentation on the papacy in Revelation 13. And we are looking forward to his presentation to our hearts again this morning. And he'll be introduced in a moment. But I just want to take a moment, and I hope the family's here. I've not seen the family yet, but then again, I don't see everything. But we want to welcome to the university church, a new family that has joined us recently at the University of the Southern Caribbean. Dr. Keturah Williams Howell is a daughter of the soil, and I'm looking to see if I get some signals that she. All right, beautiful. Dr. Keturah Williams Howell is a daughter of the soil. A graduate of the University of the Southern Caribbean, went abroad to the United States, completed master's and doctoral work in cell biology, has been working at Howard University, and this January has begun work here at USC as the new dean of the School of Science and Technology. I want to welcome her this morning. Please, I invite her to stand. Dr. Williams Howell has already taken up a job with energy and gusto, and we look forward to her leadership of the School of Technology, a position that we were looking for some time. I'm going to ask you to remain standing as I introduce your dear husband. You come not alone, but you come with your husband, Gary, who works in the construction field. We want to welcome Gary Howell here with us. This couple has been doing very well in the United States, but Gary tells me that ever since his wife was completing her doctoral work, she had a passion to come back and serve in her own institution. And he says, I'm following my wife. So I praise the Lord for that kind of unity and harmony with that couple. They have three children with them that have returned. We have Makeda, 17-year-old, who's completing high school in the United States. And Manet is currently at our primary school. And Mafal, who's in preschool. So we welcome the family and the three children. Let's all welcome them with a loud amen, church, this morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The presenter of God's Word today comes from Loma Linda University, Dean of the School of Religion and professor serving there. He has authored many books, numbering about 25 or more, and has written over 200 articles. I was privileged to be under his tutelage during my academic pilgrimage at Andrews University several years ago. And he is a specialist in Revelation studies and also Johannine studies. He has three children, a beautiful wife, Pamela. They are praying for him at this time. And so let's pray for him as he brings God's word to us. This afternoon, he'll be presenting again and answering all your questions at our special session at 4 o'clock this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, after the announcement of the next item of special music, the next voice you will hear is the voice of Dr. John Pauline. Ladies and gentlemen, give him a round of applause.
Today it is my pleasure and honor to introduce to you our special item of music that will be presented by the University Singers and conducted by Mr. Eldon Blackman. May your hearts be blessed.
to my heavenly home. No, never gonna walk alone. No, never gonna walk as one is alone. No, never gonna walk alone. The Lord will see me over to my heavenly home. Weary pilgrim, please don't give up now.
There's nothing coming in.
And treat your feet
to make you his prey.
But when temptation starts to close in,
God will make a way to escape from sin.
Escape.
No, never gonna walk.
I bring you greetings this morning from Loma Linda University in Southern California, where the weather right now is almost as good as here. So I didn't miss too much, but grateful to be here and feel very much at home with you all. Even got to go liming with the pastor the other night, so that was pretty good, right? Nice to see your students doing well, and I'm proud of you. About 20 years ago, I had the opportunity to teach an entire quarter in Jerusalem. And we had a group of students, more than 30 in number, and they were pastors, had about 37 people staying in a compound designed for 24. So it was an exciting time, but we had a whole 10 weeks, mostly in Jerusalem. And we were in the Palestinian section of Jerusalem, which is right close to the wall of the old city. And so it was only a short walk. I think Pastor Faz had that opportunity a couple of years afterward. But on this particular occasion, we added a tour of Turkey. And we flew to Turkey and we all got into a bus. There were 37 of us. And then there was a driver and a guide. And the driver and the guide were Muslims. And they were hard smoking and hard drinking Muslims. So they called themselves bad Muslims. And we were the good Muslims, according to them, the Seventh-day Adventists. So we began our journey, and we made a stop along the side of the road for lunch. And I don't know if it was something we ate there or something we had in Egypt the week before. But all of a sudden, everybody in the bus got sick, except the two. You see where this is going? It was amazing. It was a rolling sickness, because the people in the front half of the bus would start getting better, and the people in the back half would sneeze, and the people in the front would get it all over again. And then the people in the back would be feeling better, and the cycle would continue. The entire journey in Turkey, all 11 days, we were horribly sick. And I don't want to be too graphic this morning, but this was an illness that required sudden stops in the countryside. Boys to the right, girls to the left, and hopefully plenty of bushes. It was not pretty. But do you see what's going on? You have a bus full of Seventh-day Adventist pastors. They are health reformers, careful about their diet, getting their exercise and all of that. And the only two people on the bus who were healthy were chain-smoking, hard-drinking Muslims. And I'll tell you, the Seventh-day Adventists on that bus were feeling guilty and confused. And then we got to a place that in ancient times was called Philadelphia, brotherly love. And the amazing thing about it is it seems that that characteristic of the community has remained, even though that community is no longer Christian, but is Muslim today. It was simply amazing how the people treated us in that community. We were sick. We were irritable. By this point of the journey, the guy didn't want to have anything to do with us anymore. He was so upset. Because everybody was sick and grumpy, and we were not acting Christ-like at all. And as I was going through the central square, there was a man who had a vegetable stand. And he calls out to me and says, "Take a picture of my stand." Now, I knew what that meant in Egypt. You take picture, you give me money. I wasn't interested. Bakshish, yeah. Well, he seemed like nice enough, so I thought, okay, I'll take a picture of your vegetable stand. And when I had taken the picture, he went, "Wait." He got out a bag, filled the bag with vegetables from his stand, handed it to me and said, "Thank you for honoring me with your picture." I was not used to that. And then we went down the street looking for something to eat, and we found a little family place. And they had Turkish bread, and they have a wonderful cheese bread in Turkey. It's called burek. And it's a long thing that they put the dough out, and it's like a bowl, except it's only about this wide. And they put cheese in there and herbs in there, and then they put it into a big oven, a brick oven. And when it comes out, that is good. We ate some of that bread and we ate some of the salad. Eight of us were eating. And we ate to the full. And then came the bill. For eight of us, it was $5, the equivalent of about 30 trinnies, you know? I mean, that's nothing for a wonderful meal. And I was thinking, wow, these people are amazing. And so, wanting to express our gratitude, I didn't give him $5, I gave him 6.5. I said, just a little gift for you and gratitude for the wonderful meal. Well, you don't want to be ridiculous, right? My family, five of us, we headed back for the bus because children take their time. The children were small at the time. And so we left three of the students there to finish the meal. And when we got to the bus, they didn't come. And they didn't come, and these were usually on time. Finally, they came, carrying a mountain of packages. The man was so grateful for the tip that he said, you must wait. We will cook a whole nother meal and give it back to you to have later on today. Did the whole meal a second time, gave it to them. Brotherly love. We were ashamed of who we were. And we began to think, these people don't need the gospel. They are more Christ-like than we are. What is the point of having a crusade in this country, even if you could? I mean, these people are nicer, they're kinder, they're more like Jesus. I mean, we were horrible on that whole trip, and so much for health reform. We flew back to Jerusalem, back to our little compound, and the pastors were feeling guilty and confused about what it means to be a Seventh-day Adventist. What difference does it make to be a Seventh-day Adventist? And one evening, the doorbell rang. Not too common. It's usually a pretty dark street at night. We wondered who it is. We went out to the door. And guess who was waiting for us there? Pastor Robert Falkenberg, president of the General Conference. And he said, I wanted to come and see, you know, the Adventist building here in East Jerusalem. And I was hoping maybe there'd be some good vegetarian food. And that we were able to do. And so we had the General Conference president for supper with us in Jerusalem. And of course, the pastors were coming up to me and saying, could we have him afterward for questions and answers, right? And so I asked Elder Falkenberg, would you mind after supper staying by and having a time for questions and answers with this group of pastors? And he said, I'll be happy to do that. Do you know what the first question was? The very first question was telling the story of Turkey. And how the pastor says, we don't feel like we could take the Adventist message to Turkey because they're already better than we are. We wouldn't do them any good. What's the point of being a Seventh-day Adventist in Turkey? What's the point of preaching the message? Tough question, right? Elder Falkenberg gave a very short answer. You have it in the church bulletin. He simply said, we are a people of prophecy. That was it. We are a people of prophecy. That's the reason to go. And what I believe he meant was, is simply this. Adventists may not be kinder than other people, although that would be nice. We may not be gentler than other people. We may not be more Christ-like than other people, although that would be nice, would support the message. The point is, we were not called for that. We were called to give the world a message from Bible prophecy. Things are not what they seem to be. The message of the book of Revelation, the message of Bible prophecy, is that at the end of the world, things will not be as they seem to be. What I would like to do this morning is preach Revelation 13 all over again. Many of you were here on Thursday, and we talked about it in a very different context. And we talked about the Middle Ages, and we talked about what Adventists believe about some of the troubles that came upon the world in the Middle Ages and again at the end of the world. But I'd like to do it differently this morning. This morning, I would like you to forget everything you ever heard about Revelation 13 and simply listen to the story. Because there's a story in Revelation 13 that we usually overlook. And when you know that story, the chapter will shine with a fresh light, and it will answer the question, what difference does Bible prophecy make in today's world? I invite you to open your Bibles. Come with me to Revelation 12 and verse 17. And then from there we will go into chapter 13. Revelation 12 and verse 17. I hope you have your Bibles. I have my Bible, military grade iPad, because I drop the thing so much. So this one survives. It can accept bullets even. Revelation 12, 17. I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. Then the dragon became furious with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her offspring, on those who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus. So basically, there's a story here. It's a story about a dragon on the one hand and a remnant on the other hand. And it says that the dragon went away to make war with the remnant. Now that's sort of strange. That's not the way you go about it. You see, Pastor Foz, stand up just a moment. If I wanted to make war with Pastor Foz, I would just walk right up to him and punch him right in the nose. Now, you don't have to worry this morning. This afternoon, you better be careful. But you see, if you're going to make war with somebody, go right after them, you see? But it says the dragon went away to make war. Now, where I come from, we call that chicken. You know, chicken is when you don't have the courage to fight. Why does the dragon do this? You need to understand the bigger story. In chapter 12, the dragon has been fighting a war. And he fought a war against the child that was born of the woman. And then he goes up to heaven and he fights against Michael in heavenly places. And then he goes out into the desert and he tries to destroy the woman in the desert. This dragon is a loser. He has lost every fight that he's been in right from the beginning. And now he comes to the very last battle of Earth's history. And he realizes this is his last chance. And he realizes he has been losing all the way through. So he says, I need help. I'm not going into the last battle without allies. And so it tells us that he stood on the sand of the sea. In other words, when the dragon goes away, he goes to the beach. This is a strange war, all right? Forget everything you know about this text. Just follow the story. You know, we can say a lot of other things about the chapter. We did that on Thursday. But right now, stay with the story. I want you to see something very startling. And so he goes to the beach. And he's going to the beach looking for allies. And he finds them. A gigantic monster comes up out of the sea. And then he turns around and a gigantic monster comes up out of the earth. And now you have a dragon, a sea monster, and a land monster. Three of them. Now, does the number three matter here? I think so. Because throughout the book, up until this place, God has always been pictured in terms of threes. He's the one who is and who was and who is to come. And so God is pictured in threes. Now you have the dragon, the sea beast, and the land beast, once again three. So if you're following the whole story of the book, you're getting suspicious. Is this some sort of counterfeit trinity? Is this some attempt at a counterfeit God? Could the dragon be a counterfeit of God the Father. I mean, he is the one in charge. He is the one that got all this thing started. Well, let's take a look at this idea. Let's go to chapter 13. And in chapter 13, verse 1, it says, I saw a beast rising out of the sea with 10 horns and 7 heads, with 10 diadems on its horns and blasphemous names on its heads. And the beast that I saw was like a leopard, its feet were like a bear's, and its mouth was like a lion's mouth, and so on. I want you to notice something, first of all. Since this is a story, don't try to define who this sea beast is just yet. Let's just look at the story. And you notice the beast is coming up out of the sea. And you notice that the characteristics of the beast come in the order that they come out of the sea. Now, if you have an animal coming out of the sea, what's the first thing you're going to see? You would think so, except in this case, it's horns, right? So out of the water come horns, and then head, and then body, and then feet, and then the animal starts speaking, and so the attention goes to the mouth. So you're seeing the animal. You're trying to capture a vision, a story of what's happening. The dragon is on the beach. This animal is coming toward him. First the horns, then the heads, and so on. Now, this is a very strange creature. He's got 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, if you were to go out into a field here in Trinidad, or perhaps into the jungle, you know, and you came upon an animal with 7 heads and 10 horns, what would you know? You've been drinking again. Been liming a little too much, Pastor. Yeah. So, it's not normal. This isn't an animal out of real life. This is an animal out of fantasy. The vision creates something that doesn't exist in real life. However, the interesting part of this is if you've been reading the story, in chapter 12, you discover that the dragon has 7 heads and 10 horns. Now, if you're sober and you see 2 animals with 7 heads and 10 horns, what do you know? You've just discovered a new species. The beast from the sea looks just like the dragon. Now remember we said, could it be that the dragon is a counterfeit of God the Father? And if so, who's the sea beast? Could he be a counterfeit of Jesus Christ? Do you remember the words of Jesus? If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. If you've seen the sea beast, you have seen the dragon, because they look just alike. The sea beast appears to be a counterfeit of Jesus Christ. Verse 2 again. The beast that I saw was like a leopard, its feet were like a bear's, and its mouth was like a lion's mouth. And to it the dragon gave his power, his throne, and great authority. So where did the sea beast get his authority? From the dragon. Where did Jesus get his authority? Matthew 28, verse 18. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Who gave it to Jesus? His Father. The dragon gives his authority to the sea beast. Jesus gets his authority from the Father. This beast from the sea is a counterfeit of Jesus Christ. Verse 3. One of its heads seemed to have a mortal wound, but its mortal wound was healed, and the whole earth marveled as they followed the beast. Now, I think we might miss what's going on here because of the translation. At times. If you read it in the Greek, It says one of his heads was, as it were, slaughtered to death. In fact, the word for slaughter is a typical word for sacrifice. Greek has four or five different words for death and for killing. This particular one is the word for sacrifice. This beast is, as it were, sacrificed to death. But its deadly wound, its wound unto death, is healed. Now, somebody dies and they get healed. What do you call that? It's a resurrection. In verse 14, we won't take time to look at it right now, but in verse 14, it talks about the beast who died and came to life. And it uses a typical Greek word there for resurrection, ezeisan. So this beast suffers a death and a resurrection. Keep your finger at verse 3 and just go to verse 8 for a moment. Revelation 13, verse 8. It says, all who dwell on earth will worship it, the sea beast, everyone whose name has not been written before the foundation of the world in the book of life of the Lamb who was slain. That word slain is exactly the same Greek word as the mortal wound of verse 3. Now again, you would not necessarily see that in translation. But the death of the sea beast uses exactly the same word as the death of the lamb. The sea beast is a deliberate counterfeit of Jesus Christ, even counterfeiting his death and his resurrection. Do you see what a story we have going here? When you stop and look at the story, amazing things begin to come to light. But it doesn't end there. In verse 4, they worshiped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is like the beast? Now that may not mean anything to you at first, until you discover that the name Michael is what in Hebrew? Who is like God? The previous name for Jesus Christ in this book is Michael in chapter 12. And now the beast takes upon himself that name. Who is like the beast? The beast even counterfeits the role of Jesus Christ in heavenly places. But it gets even more interesting in verse 5. It says, the beast was given a mouth uttering haughty and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for how long? 42 months. So this beast has a ministry, if you will, that lasts 42 months. Now again, you probably have other ideas about that, and that's okay. But for now, just stick with the story. How long is 42 months? 3.5 years. How long was Jesus' ministry? 3.5 years. Do you think that's an accident? The beast from the sea is a deliberate, detailed counterfeit of Jesus Christ. Some scholars have as many as 13 or 14 parallel characteristics. I was just sharing some of the more obvious ones. So the dragon is a counterfeit of God the Father. The sea beast is a counterfeit of Jesus Christ. There's one more beast here. It's the land beast. Could this be a counterfeit of the Holy Spirit? Well, let's take a look. You know, the idea sounds good, but let's make sure that it's biblical. Chapter 13, verse 11 takes us to the other beast. Then I saw another beast rising out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It's interesting. It says, I saw another beast. Now, once again, coming back to the original language, the Greek has two words for another. One word means another just like the first one, and the other word means another that's very different from the first one. This is the one that means they're very much alike. Another beast like the first one. Now, in the upper room, when Jesus was talking about the Holy Spirit, what did he call the Holy Spirit? The Comforter, right? That's almost right. He actually said something a little more. He doesn't call the Holy Spirit the Comforter. He calls the Holy Spirit another Comforter. And he uses this word, the word that means another one just like the first. You see, if you go back and read the story in John 14, the disciples are depressed. They have heard rumors that Jesus is going away. And they're very disappointed about these rumors. They don't want to lose Jesus. He's been the center of their life. If Jesus lived at your house, would you ever want him to leave? Definitely not. And they're depressed, and they don't know what to make of this information. And at that moment, Jesus says, don't be depressed. Don't be discouraged. I will send you another Comforter. What is Jesus saying? I will send you someone just like me to take care of you. Yes, I'm going away. Yes, you're not going to see me for a while. But I will send you another Comforter. Who's the Comforter? Jesus. So the Holy Spirit comes to take the place of Jesus, to do what Jesus had done for them while he was on this earth. And so here we see another beast, this one coming up out of the earth. But that's not enough. Let's go further and see if there's any more evidence here. Verse 12, this beast that comes up out of the earth exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose mortal wound was healed. It's interesting. This beast from the earth seems to be a really big guy, really powerful. And yet he doesn't promote himself. He commands the world to worship the sea beast. His thoughts are not about himself, but his focus is on the sea beast. Again in John, Jesus says of the Holy Spirit, he will not come to promote himself. He will not come to speak of himself, but he will speak of me. The Holy Spirit came to promote Jesus Christ. The land beast came to promote the sea beast. The land beast is a counterfeit of the Holy Spirit. Verse 13. Revelation 13, verse 13. It, the land beast, performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of people. Did the Holy Spirit ever bring fire from heaven to earth? Acts chapter 2. We call it Pentecost. When Jesus ascended to heaven, when he was enthroned at the right hand of God, he sent out the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit came with fire, tongues of fire coming down from heaven and lighting on each one of these. At the end of time, a counterfeit Holy Spirit will come. A counterfeit Holy Spirit will point to a counterfeit Jesus and will demonstrate that Jesus is the true Jesus by bringing fire down from heaven, a new Pentecost. The Holy Spirit will be counterfeited by the beast from the earth. And in case any of the Greek scholars still have doubts, go to verse 15, where it says it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast. Now, you Greek scholars out there, you know that in both Greek and Hebrew, the word breath and the word wind and the word spirit is the same word. When he breathed into the nostrils of Adam the breath of life, it's the same Hebrew word for spirit. When the wind is over the waters before creation, it's the same word as spirit. And that's why that word is translated spirit in Genesis 1, breath in Genesis 2, and wind in Genesis 8, the wind over the flood. Same word. And the Hebrews would make connections on the basis of that same word being used in different ways. This counterfeit spirit gives breath to the image of the beast so that that image would come to life. What are we to make of this story? What is the purpose of this story? It is simply this. In the last days of Earth's history, things will not be as they seem to be. You will see powerful manifestations of the Spirit, but it won't be the Holy Spirit. You will see powerful manifestations of Jesus Christ. Ellen White suggests that at some point Satan himself will impersonate Jesus Christ, will walk on this earth and do the miracles that Jesus did. You will see Jesus walking, you will feel the Spirit's presence, and it will be a counterfeit. The Trinity will be presented before the world, and it will be a counterfeit. In the last days of Earth's history, what your eyes see, and what your ears hear, and what your hands handle will deceive you. You will become convinced through scientific method that the message of prophecy that you were given was a mistake. In fact, there's another background to this story. Is there another place in the Bible where fire comes down from heaven? It's at the mountain of Megiddo. Armageddon means mountain of Megiddo. And there is no mountain named Megiddo, but there is a mountain overlooking Megiddo, and that mountain is called Carmel. It was on Mount Carmel that there was a showdown between the God of Israel and the gods of the Canaanites. And in that showdown, the challenge was, the true God will be the one who brings fire down from heaven. According to Bible prophecy, in the last days of Earth's history, the Mount Carmel experience will be repeated in some way. Don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying literal fire from heaven. I'm not saying literally on Mount Carmel. But that story is a background for what will happen worldwide at the end of time. That worldwide at the end of time, there will be a challenge to the true God, a challenge to the gospel, a challenge even to the second coming of Jesus, a counterfeit of Jesus' ministry, a counterfeit of Jesus' second coming. In the face of all that, it will be as if at Mount Carmel the fire had fallen on the wrong altar. What your eyes will see, what your ears will hear, what your hands will handle will be telling you, I was wrong. It's not working out the way the Bible said it would. You know, Adventists sometimes feel comfortable moving into the end time saying, well, we're prepared. You know, we know all the prophecies. We know all these things. We know what's going to happen. Everything's going to be cool. I'll tell you, when that day comes, Jesus says even the elect, if it were possible, would be deceived. What is the purpose of the Seventh-day Adventist message and mission? It's to warn the world that in the last days of Earth's history, things will not be as they seem to be. Your eyes and your ears will deceive you. When that day comes, what is the answer? What is the only safeguard in a world that's filled with deception? That safeguard would be God's word. The safeguard on that day is that it was told us in advance. God, looking down the corridors of history, predicted that at the end of time, there'll be a counterfeit Trinity, a counterfeit gospel, a counterfeit second coming. And that his own people would tremble in the face of that tremendous deception. And the message of this story today is the only safe place is to be grounded in God's word. If you trust in what your eyes see and your ears hear and your hands handle, you will be deceived. Scientific method is a wonderful thing. At Loma Linda, we practice it all over the campus. That is the Seventh-day Adventist Stanford Science University. And God has been able to do some wonderful things through that blending of faith and science. But science without scripture can lead you astray. And God calls his people, whether scientists or not, to be grounded in his word. What difference should this story make in our lives today? I would suggest three things. If this story of our future is true, we believe that God's word is true, then I think there's three things we ought to be doing right now. Number one, we ought to pray as we have never prayed before. We ought to study God's word as we have never studied God's word before. And number three, we need to come at that prayer and come at that study in a spirit of self-distrust. What do I mean by that? Self-distrust. Because for me, the easiest thing in the world is to read the Bible in order to confirm what I already believe. And I think most people just read the Bible to confirm what they already believe. But that's not studying the Word of God. That's not allowing the Word of God to change us. The Word of God to open our minds and hearts. To, as Ellen White says, lead us ever brighter and brighter into truth. When we come at the Word of God out of confidence that we understand it, we will miss the story. I won't ask for a show of hands, but I'm curious, how many of you have never heard this story before? And yet it's there, isn't it? Isn't it clear as day once you see it? That is why it is so important to come to the Word of God with an attitude of self-distrust. To consider the possibility that through the Word of God, you might learn something. You might grow. Those who are grounded in God's Word, those who know the clear teachings of Scripture will not be deceived. That is the safeguard for the end of time. At the end of time, things will not be as they seem to be. And as we prepare for those days, we need to pray as we've never prayed before, study as we've never studied before, and be humble and teachable as never before. May that be your goal and your experience here at USC, is my prayer.
Brethren, let us remember to be grounded in the Word of God. Let us pray and let us study God's word, and we will commit ourselves when we study and pray the word of God. Today we are indeed thankful to God for using his manservant, Dr. Pauline, once again. And we hope that God will continue to bless him and his family as he ministers. Our closing hymn, is hymn number 604, We Know Not the Hour. The grace of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all, now and forever. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.